Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update from Rouse IS. So now we are also officially available on Telegram. To get the latest updates from Rouse IS, join the official Telegram channel of Rouse IS, the link for which has been shared in the description box below. Hello students, as a part of our Prelim Compass series of the books of prelims for 2021, we have released the second book, that is History and Culture of India. We will be releasing other books shortly. Also, the Quality Improvement Program, which is a focus program aimed at students taking prelims this year, is also beginning from the 12th of the April. Students can visit Rouse website to enroll for it. Hello and welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we'll be taking up the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 6th April 2021. Now the articles to be discussed are reflected on your screen and the time stamping has been provided in the description box below. So now let's begin. Now this article appearing on the page number 14 of the Hindu newspaper talks about the recent ordinance that the government has introduced to amend the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code. Now this ordinance aims to introduce pre-packaged insolvency resolution options that are also known as pre-packs for facilitating the insolvency of micro, small and medium enterprises as per the global best practices. Now this new mechanism provides for an informal plan such that the creditors and the debtors can informally sit together and plan a resolution mechanisms in advance and then send it for approval. Now till the time this process is undergoing, the original management has the option of continuing their operations, and hence in this regard it is very different from the general bankruptcy provisions that does not allow the incumbent management to continue to control till the final deal has been arrived. And hence this pre-packaged scheme provides for an easier mechanism and for an informal channel to undertake insolvency and the bankruptcy resolution. Now this scheme is applicable in two conditions. The first condition is that the entities must not have availed any bankruptcy proceeding in past 3 years. Second criteria suggests that there must not be any major shareholder that is an undischarged insolvent or a willful defaulter that has willfully defaulted on their loans. And thus this scheme paves way for a new kind of resolution mechanism. Now let us look from the prelims point of view into the definition of MSME and study a bit about the issues that the MSE sector has been facing. Now based on the recommendation of the UK Sinha committee that had provided measures for enhancing the functioning of the MSME in India, the government has undertaken revision of the MSME classification. Now these are the revised classification that was brought out in the 2020 mid-year. And thus it is very important from the point of view of the prelims examination. Now the first criteria that has changed with respect to previous definition is that the government has merged the criteria for manufacturing and services. Earlier there was a difference with respect to the classification. Now the government has merged and adopted a uniform method of classification. Further, the government has enhanced the investment limit in plants and equipment such that it reflects the current price indexes. Now the last classification was introduced in 2006. Now in these more than 15 years, there has been lot of changes with respect to price index, and hence the government has enhanced the investment level that were introduced earlier. Now with respect to micro enterprises, earlier why the investment limit was 25 for manufacturing and 10 lakhs for service sector, it has been enhanced to 1 crore. With respect to small enterprises, while it was 5 crores for manufacturing and 2 crores for service sector, now it has increased to 10 crores. And last, with respect to medium enterprises, while it was 10 crores for manufacturing and 5 crores for service sector, it has been increased to whopping 50 crores. Further, another important difference that has been introduced is that the government now has introduced a turnover criteria alongside investment criteria for classification. Now for micro enterprises, the turnover requirement is less than 5 crores. For small enterprises, it is less than 50 crores, and for medium enterprises, it is less than 250 crores. Thus, clearly, the new classification are more in line with the trends of the economy and hence are more reflective of the need of the time. Further, let us study a bit more about MSME. Now, it is suggested that the MSME in India employs 111 million people and is the second largest employer after agriculture, and hence makes lot of contribution to the country's economy. Now, it contributes 28% to India's overall GDP and 45% to India's manufacturing output. And hence, the MSME sector is very critical for economy's overall growth and prosperity. Now, let us look into some of the key challenges that are affecting this MSME sector. Now, the first and the most important challenge is with respect to lack of access to working capital. Now, like any other industry, MSME also requires capital to stay afloat. However, given their small size, they are not often obliged to maintain any financial records because they are not part of GST framework. And hence, because of this lack of documentation, they are not able to avail formal capital from the formal banking channels and are actually dependent on non-formal channels, which are often very expensive. Now, as reflected in the World Bank's data, the India's informal banking channel has only been able to supply to 1/3 of the total demand of the MSME sector. And 2/3 of the MSME needs is dependent on informal channels that are often very expensive and charge steep interest rate, which later affect overall viability of the sector. Now, the next important challenge is with respect to poor productivity from inefficient process and unskilled workforce. Now, as we had seen previously, India has barely 2.5% of the workforce that is skilled. And this small limited amount of workforce that is skilled is very expensive. And hence, it is not in the capacity of the small medium enterprises to avail this skilled workforce. This absence of an efficient human resource compromises with the process. Further, they are also running backward with respect to the technology upgradation. And most of the time, they are functioning with age-old technologies that are neither efficient nor fast, as a result of which even their productivity is reduced, which costs them dearly with respect to their business activity. Now, the next important challenge is with respect to lack of market access. Now, market access is crucial for growth of any enterprise. Now, the MSME sector that often works out of brick and mortar model are not able to access the market given they have geographical restraints. And because of this, they are actually not able to access even the global value chain, because of which their ability to enhance their revenue is diminished, hurting their overall long-term economic prospects. Now, moving on to the last challenge, that is with respect to perverse incentive. Now, this was explained in detail in the Economic Survey of 2018-19, wherein it talked about various government incentives that have been extended to MSME. Now, these incentives include exemption from labor laws, inclusion in priority sector lending targets, inclusion in public procurement policy via the government's GEM portal, the inclusion in credit guarantee fund scheme, and the GST composition scheme. The purpose behind extending these incentives was to ensure that these MSME turn into giant companies. They are able to enhance their productivity, enhance job creation, reap demographic dividend, and foster entrepreneurship. However, what has happened is very sad, is that these incentives have actually incentivize these MSME to stay dwarf. That is the lure of ensuring these incentives keep flowing. These companies have stayed small so as to be able to fulfill this criteria of MSME. And this has resulted in low productivity, low employment generation, and in turn, low economic efficiency of the companies. And it is because of this perverse incentive that 99% of the MSME employ less than 10 workers. Further, even the World Bank has reported that in India, the average number of employees of a 40-year-old plant is almost equivalent to that of a 5-year-old counterpart. And hence, as the age of the company grows, its size is not growing. And hence, it was suggested in the Economic Survey of 2018-19 that these incentives must be extended based on the criteria of age and not the size of the company. So that it is the small and the infant company that get the benefit and become big. And thus the economic survey recommended that there is a need to incentivize infant firms instead of small firms. Further, it also suggested that there is a need to introduce a sunset clause of 5 to 7 years with respect to incentives that have been extended by the government. The second recommendation talked about the reorientation of priority sector lending, wherein it was suggested that under the MSME PSL targets, there was a need to prioritize infant firms such as startups. Third, there was a need to focus on high employment elastic sectors such as textile and leather. And at last, it called for deregulating labor laws. Further, the government of India, although had implemented certain recommendation of UK Sinha committee, but there are certain more provisions that are still pending and must be implemented. These include creation of MSME council, enhancing the capacity building of these firms so as to ensure higher productivity, enhancing access to credit. One of the ways could be priority sector lending, other way could be to enhance the non-collateral loans to these companies, and development of MSME clusters. Now, these were the key recommendations that are still waiting implementation. Now, implementing these recommendations along with those suggested by the 2018-19 economic survey holds key to rejuvenate the micro, medium, small enterprise sector in the country. Now, moving on to the next article. Now, this article appearing on the editorial page of the Hindu newspaper that has been titled as Pillars of an Equitable Post-COVID India has been written in the backdrop of various global reports that are increasingly pointing out towards a highly inequitable post-pandemic world. Now, one such report that the author quotes here is the PEW report. Now, PEW is an American think tank that is based out of Washington. Now, as per this report, the middle class in India is seen to have shrunk by 1/3%, while the poor and the extremely poor class that earn less than 150 rupees per day has more than doubled. Now, these are grave stats that point out towards the growing inequality and the need to address this once this COVID pandemic is over. Now, since this topic talks about the inequality issue in the country, it falls under the mandate of GS Paper 2, subsection Social Justice. Further, since it also talks about economic inequality and need of addressing it, it can also be asked under GS Paper 3, subsection Economic Development. Now, as we move ahead in this article, we'll first discuss the various impact that COVID pandemic has across the various socio-economic sections of the society. And next we'll move towards the certain measures and suggestions that the author has made in this article with respect to removing this inequality and ensuring an equitable post-COVID India. So now let's begin. Now, this inequality, as we witness in our day-to-day experiences, has always been engraved in Indian society, especially with respect to caste, class, gender-based inequalities. Now, these inequalities especially have arisen in the last 3 decades, especially since the 1991 reforms that gave a boost to private sector. And since then, we are witnessing a growing disparity with respect to the growing income wealth inequality in India. Now, this was the Oxfam report that has reported that top 10% of the Indian population holds 77% of the national wealth. Now, if this is not wealth accumulation, then what is? And it has suggested that it will take as much as 941 years for a minimum wage worker in rural India to earn what a top paid executive earns in an Indian garment company. Now, this is the huge disparity that already existed in Indian society. And thus, it was believed that this coronavirus will act as an equalizer and it will give rise to a level playing platform, such that the inequalities that were inherent in the Indian society will reduce, giving rise to a more equitable society. However, this has not really happened, and instead what has happened is that the rich is getting richer faster while the poor are still struggling to earn a basic minimum income. Now let us try to see how different sections of economy and society have been affected by this growing inequality. Now starting off with income inequality. Now it was the end of March last year when the lockdown was enforced, and it was in the month of April, as you can see, there has been a massive peak in the unemployment. As much as 24% of the people of India were unemployed in the month of April 2020. Now majority of which accounted for the informal or the unorganized sector. Because of the safety protocols, the norms of social distancing, it was the lower strata of the society, such as the laborers and the house help, that were massively affected, and this resulted in the exodus of workers towards the villages. Now, while one section of the society was struggling to make 2 square meals a day and thus were returning back to their homes, often walking back thousands of kilometers, there was other section of the society that are involved in the white collar jobs, that were working out of the comfort of their homes and laptops. And this reflects the stark inequality with respect to incomes that the country witnessed during the COVID pandemic, especially during the month of April, wherein the lockdown was enforced. Now, next important factor is with respect to wealth. Now, the recently released report by the Oxfam that has been titled as the Inequality Virus presents that the India's richest billionaires have been able to increase their wealth by as much as 35% during the COVID pandemic, while on the other hand, the number of people falling below the poverty line have increased as much as 75 million in 1 year in India. How contrasting is this wealth inequality that we are witnessing in the country during the COVID pandemic? Now, this inequality with respect to income and wealth has given rise to health inequality, because of which the top 20% of the households had 93% access to sanitation resources, while only 6% of the bottom 20 had access to the similar resources. Now, as a result of which, there was a swift spread of disease among the poor communities, as was witnessed in the case of Dharavi slum of Mumbai. Now, Dharavi, being the world's largest slum, has lot of people living in cramped areas with poor access to sanitation, toilets and water points. And as a result of which, it was very easy for COVID pandemic to spread in these regions. And thus, disparity with respect to access to health services gave rise to inequality with respect to how virus affected different sections of the society. Now, moving on to the education sector. Now, education, as we all know, moved online. Now, it was the digital education that undertook when school and colleges were shut down because of the lockdown. But because of the pre-existing digital divide, the education divide has further worsened because of the COVID pandemic. Now, as ESER reports suggest, there has been a less than 1/3 of the total population of children that had access to online education, which means as much as 2/3 of the India's children were not able to learn anything in this COVID year. And as a result of which, what we are seeing is a learning gap that has been arising with risk that will affect the future human resource of the country. Further, the report suggests now out of the 1/3 of the students that had access to online education, even fewer were able to take online classes. Now, this is because of lack of digital literacy, lack of adequate access to digital devices. Now, given in a household there is one digital device, it is often the head of the household or the father who will be using it, and as a result of which, education of these children get compromised. Now, the next important parameter is class. Now, as was reported in the article, that the PEW research has found that the middle class in India is estimated to have shrunk by 32 million in 2020. Now, as is evident, The upper class or the higher income category group has not been much affected by the COVID pandemic and they have retained their size. In fact, as a report had already suggested, there has been an increase in the wealth of the Indian millennials. The main affected category is the middle class. Now, it is the middle class that has shrunk and has fallen into the poor category. Now, there has been a reduction of as much as 74 million among the middle class category, and there has been an increase of 75 million in the poor class category. That is, the people who have not been able to sustain themselves have fallen below the poverty line, which is a grave concern given it took India so much time to actually raise these people above the poverty line. And reports have suggested that it might take these poor people as much as 10 years to return to their original status, that is the middle class category. Now, the next important category is with respect to growing gender inequality. Now, the pandemic saw the women unemployment rate to rise to as much as 18% from already existing 15%. Now, out of the women who were actually retained for the job, even 83% of those have witnessed a cut in their salaries. Further, the women folks had to suffer from the problem of enhanced domestic violence that rose to as much as 60% in the past 12 months of the COVID pandemic. Now, this was because of the increased frustration among the male members of the society who have often used women as their tool to wrench out their frustration. Now, another factor that affected women in this COVID pandemic is the health. Now, because of the shutdown of Anganwadis, many of the women were not able to access any health services. As a result of which, there were millions of unintended pregnancies, abortions, including maternal death, because majority of these abortions were unsafe. And hence, women as a category have been affected massively by the COVID pandemic. Gender inequality has further deepened in the Indian society. Now, moving on to the last category, that is the caste-based inequality, that too has seen a rise in the COVID pandemic. Now, the SC/ST population have often been at the bottom rung in terms of economy and as well as social dynamics. Now, they are also suffering from other challenges such as access to health, education, sanitation, water, etc. And hence the pandemic that created restrictions with respect to all these services have further caused the subjugation of the lower caste categories. And hence the caste inequalities in the Indian society has further deepened given the economic upliftment or the Dalit upliftment movement that have been undergoing over the years have seen a pause during this pandemic, and further the economic independence and economic well-being of this section of the society has seen a setback. Now, understanding how the COVID pandemic have affected the various social economic sections of the society, let us look into the solutions that the author is providing with this regard. Now, given the massive rise in unemployment over the past 1 year, the first suggestion that the author makes is with respect to enhancing the employment opportunities in the country. Herein he suggests that we need as much as 7 to 8 million jobs per year. Now, in order to do so, he has given certain measures. That is, the first, that we need to enhance the investment rate in the economy that has been falling over the years. Now, investment rate was as much as 39% in 2011 and 12 and has fallen down to 31.7% in 2018 and 19, which is a cause of worry. Now, in this regard, the author is suggesting there is a need to enhance capital investment in the country so as to boost not only construction activity but also to enhance the employment generation opportunities. Further, with respect to manpower, the author is suggesting the need to enhance skill training. Now, in India, only 2.3% of the workforce is skilled, which is very low compared to South Korea that has as much as 96% of skilled resources. Now, next suggestion is with respect to bringing in structural changes in the economy, wherein the author suggests that manufacturing should become the engine of growth. Now, presently, it is the service sector that contributes maximum to the GDP. Therefore, the need of the hour, as the author suggests here, is to boost labor-intensive manufacturing and export and make manufacturing the engine of growth, given it has power to absorb a lot of labor out of the agriculture labor force and enhance the GDP and the GVA of the country. Next important segment is the need to focus on micro, small and medium enterprises alongside informal sector, because these segments not only add to the GDP of the country but also will help absorb the labor force that are coming out of the agriculture sector. Next important recommendation is to go for automation and to adopt technology revolution. Further, I suggest the need to enhance the social security and introduce a guarantee minimum wages for the labor force. And thus, these are the suggestions that the author is making with respect to enhancing productive or quality employment in the country. Now, the next important suggestion that the author gives here is with respect to enhancing the quality of opportunity. Now, what does one mean by opportunity? Now, this is mostly with respect to enhancing the capacity of the human resources of the country so that they are able to avail various opportunities with respect to employment in the country. Now, opportunities, the equality of opportunity can be availed by two main factors, that is improving the health and improving the learning, that is the education in the country. Now, herein the author suggests that the expenditure on health is one of the lowest in the world. That is, India only spends 1.5% of its GDP in health. Now, this needs to be enhanced to 2-3%, plus there is a need to move towards universal healthcare in the country. Next, author suggests that with respect to education, there is a need to move away from the obsession with respect to islands of excellence in terms of IITs and IIMs, and there is a need to enhance the grassroots education, that is the primary education that actually helps build strong basis for the children, thereby enhancing the overall quality of human resource in the country and facilitating equality of opportunity for all of these resources. Now, the next important suggestion that the author makes is with respect to introducing quasi-universal basic income. Herein, the author is suggesting that there is need to provide a social security in terms of universal basic income such that everybody has basic minimum standards of living even when they are not employed. Herein, the author suggests that there is need to enhance the number of days that are provided under the MG Narega scheme. Given the extensive work demand that has been made under MG Narega, especially during the COVID times. Next important suggestion is with respect to enhancing the tax and non-tax revenue. In terms of reintroducing the wealth tax and also recommends introducing a one-time COVID tax of 4%. Now, as we had discussed earlier, the billionaires have actually getting rich even during the pandemic. Hence, introducing a wealth tax may be a vital solution to the problem of revenues that the government has been facing. Next important suggestion is with respect to reducing the inequality between center and state in respect to the finances, so that the state government can undertake capital expenditure with respect to physical infrastructure and boost the employment generation in these states. Now, the last suggestion is with respect to increasing the farmers' income by mandating the MSP and increasing them timely. Further, given the fragmented land ratio, there is need to create farmer-producer organization so as to promote collective farming together with introducing agriculture reforms in the country. So, with this, we have seen the various types of inequality that have arisen during the COVID pandemic and certain solutions that the author is providing with respect to addressing these inequalities. So, now moving on to the next article. Now, this article appears on the page number 1 of the Hindu newspaper in context of the recent meet between Mr. Lavrov, who is Russia's foreign minister, and Mr. Jai Shankar, who is India's foreign minister. Now, this meet aims to focus on the peace effort in Afghanistan. Now, since this meet is ongoing, there is not much to discuss what will be the outcome of this meet. However, in this article, we will discuss the background of India-Russia relationship. Why has the relation stagnated over the recent years? Further, we'll suggest the future areas of cooperation for these two big economies to come together. Now, India and Russia, as we all know, have traditionally enjoyed very good and very strong relationship. Now, this is especially after India's independence, when Russia helped India to attain its economic goal of self-sufficiency through investment in various key areas such as heavy machinery, mining, energy production, and steel plants. Now, this friendship took formal turn in 1971 during the Indo-Pak War, wherein the Soviet Union and India signed the Treaty of Peace and Friendship, wherein they shared their common goal with respect to strengthening regional security and global peace. Now, after the dissolution of Soviet Union, India-Russia entered a new sort of treaty, which was known as New Treaty of Friendship and Cooperation, that was signed in 1993. Along with the signing of Bilateral Military Technical Cooperation Agreement that was signed in 1994, and since then this military technological cooperation is ever going. Now in 2000, both the countries finally signed and established a strategic partnership, and this marked a high point in the Indo-Russian relationship. Now let us look into the stagnation that this relationship has been facing in the recent years. Now, it is because of the growing economic relation between Russia and China and growing tilt of Russia towards Pakistan that India has not been very happy with its strategic partner. While on the other hand, Russia too has not been happy given India's growing proximity with the United States. Now, one of the key reasons for Russia's tilt towards India's arch enemy China is that this is done to balance the US influence in this region. And similar can be said for India's growing tilt towards US. Now again, this has been done to counter China in this region. Thus, you can understand clearly the stagnation with respect to India-Russia relationship is purely geopolitical, and hence the stagnation in India's Russia relationship is purely temporary. However, there is a need to reinvigorate this relationship. Let us look at the steps that can be used to do so. Now, few areas of cooperation where India and Russia can work together is defense, as has been in the past. But recently, India has decided to diversify its defense partnership, which by far holds 70% of its inventory from Russia. Now, Russia can be a key player here and can not only strengthen India's domestic defense manufacturing, but can also help with respect to technology transfer and investments. Next area of cooperation is with respect to North-South corridor that links India and Russia via Iran. Further, both these economies are also trying to develop Vladivostok-Chennai sea route that is soon to be operational. Now, next area of cooperation is emerging technology. Now, here India, as we had already discussed, can benefit from the high technology cooperation with Russia, especially in the field of artificial intelligence, robotics, biotechnology, outer space, and nanotechnology, wherein Russia has a powerful hold. India can also cooperate with Russia with respect to upgrading the research and education facilities. They both can mutually cooperate to develop the Arctic region and develop rules to harness the resources of this region. Further, they can together cooperate in the Indo-Pacific region where the global geopolitics is developing. Further area of cooperation lies in trade, in the energy sector, along with natural resources such as timber and agriculture. And hence, there are a lot of areas where India and Russia can cooperate to re-strengthen its relationship. One of the steps in this regard is the recent meet between the foreign affairs ministers of both these countries. Now, moving on to the next article. Now, let us take up these two news from the point of view of the prelims examination. Now, this article appearing on the page number 5 talks about the Dhubri-Fulbari bridge, while this article appearing on the page number 10 talks about the Chenab bridge. Let us look into the details of these two bridges from the point of view of the prelims examination. Now, the Prime Minister had laid the foundation of Dhubri Fulwari Bridge across the Brahmaputra River. Now, this river through which it is passing through is the Brahmaputra River, and this bridge connects two places over the Brahmaputra River, that is Dhubri, which is located in Assam, and Fulwari, which is located in Meghalaya. Now, this bridge, when developed, will be India's longest bridge and will be approximately 9.2 km long. Now, this bridge will bring lot of socio-economic relief to the region, as it will reduce the distance between these two important regions by 203 km. Now, the next important bridge to be discussed is the Chenab Rail Bridge. Now, this has been in news because the Indian Railways has completed the arch closure of this iconic bridge over the Chenab River. Now, this bridge is a part of the Udhampur-Srinagar-Baramulla Railway Link project, such that it shall connect the Kashmir Valley to the rest of the nation. And once in operation, it will become the world's highest railway bridge. Now, this bridge is supposed to be 1.3 km long. It is even larger than the Eiffel Tower. It has a life of 120 years. It has a design speed of 100 km per hour and design wind speed of 266 km per hour. Now, this bridge is also blast resistant, given it is built in such a delicate region wherein the security issues are always there. Further, it has been designed to bear earthquake with intensity of zone 5. Further, the structure of the steel used is suitable for temperature between minus 10 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius. So now we have discussed two important bridges. The first is the Dhubri Fulwari Bridge, that is supposed to be India's longest bridge. And second is Chenab Bridge, that is supposed to be world's highest railway bridge. And both of these are very important from the point of view of the prelims examination. Now, in front of you is a question of the day. Please attempt this question and provide your answer in the comment box below.